Okay, today, Yom Ha'atzma'ut, Daf Shin Ayin He. Yom Ha'atzma'ut, Daf Shin Ayin He, 70th Independence Day of Israel. We're reading, continue reading from the book Hegyonei Uziel by Rabbi Ben Zion Meir Chai Uziel. And this one is a chapter where he speaks about Shirat Yisrael, the poetry and song of Israel. And particularly now, speaking about Rabbi Yehuda Halevi. Rabbi Yehuda Halevi is the one who really deserves the title, the national poet. In modern Israel, when you ask who's the national poet, it's Chaim Nachman Bialik. With all due respect to Bialik, if you look at the totality of the poetry and the literature that we have and the intensity and beauty of the language, the one who really deserves the title is Rabbi Yehuda Halevi. He not only spoke about Shivat Zion, about going back to Zion and resettling in Eretz Yisrael, he did that at a time when it was very difficult. In the 12th century, he traveled from Spain to Egypt. It was held in Egypt by the Jewish population. They were so excited that he came that they held him for years. They didn't let him continue with his trip. And while he was there, wherever he stayed, whether it was in Alexandria or Cairo, wherever he stayed, people would flock to his house to write poetry and to share it with him, and to listen to his own creations. In the book of Kuzari, he wrote the book of Kuzari, or in its original name, the book of defense of the degraded and persecuted religion, where he defended Judaism against Islam, Christianity, paganism, and philosophy. So he did a lot for restoring the faith and pride of Jews at times where it was very difficult. And eventually he traveled to Eretz Yisrael. The legend says that he was killed by an Arab horseman upon arrival to Yerushalayim. But this is probably an urban myth. It didn't happen that way. But he died shortly after coming to Eretz Yisrael, less than a year from his arrival to Eretz Yisrael. He also represents, when we think of his aspiration to go to Israel, he represents a certain school among Sephardic rabbis and scholars, which later on also spilled to the Ashkenazi community, that believed that in order to fulfill the mitzvah of being in Eretz Yisrael, you have to physically be in Eretz Yisrael. He said that Eretz Yisrael or the temple and the center of Kedusha of sanctity is in Israel itself, and you have to be there. Meanwhile, there was another school of thought represented by Rabbi Ezra and Rabbi Azriel of Gerona in Spain, who believed that wherever you are, there is a sanctuary. Like the spiritual Eretz Yisrael travels with you. And it was a theology that was probably born out of necessity of not being able to travel out of where they lived and knowing that Am Yisrael is dispersed over many, many countries. However, this remained even until today. You know, it's a split between observant Jews. Some who believe that they should remain in exile and bring Eretz Yisrael with them wherever they are, and others who believe that you should be in Eretz Yisrael. That probably will go on until Mashiach comes. However, Rabbi Yehuda Halevi realized his dream and went to Eretz Yisrael. So one of his famous poems, Yefe Nof Mesos Tevel Kriat Melech Rab, he took, of course, using words from Tehillim, from the Tanakh, he says the following, Yefe Nof Mesos Tevel Kriat Melech Rab. He speaks of Yerushalayim. He says, you are the beautiful city, the joy of the world, Kriat Melech Rab, the seat of the throne of the great king, which is the Bet HaMikdash. Lach nichsefa nafshi mipa'atei ma'arav. My soul yearns towards you from the corners of the west. He considered, or he was, Spain to be the west, Eretz Israel is the east. Halo avanaich achonen ve'eshakim v'ta'am regavaich midevash nefi ya'arav. He says, I will embrace your stones and kiss them, and the flavor of the dust of your soil would be for me better than that of honey. This is also based on Psukim in the Tanakh, Ki Ratzu Avadecha et Avaneha v'et Afarah Yehonenu. Speaking about the redemption, the prophet says to Hashem, your servants want just the stones and dust of Eretz Yisrael are precious for them. But from this statement of Rabbi Yehuda Halevi, that the dust will be more flavorful than that of honey, it was born the custom. I'm sure you've seen that people who come to Eretz Yisrael for the first time bow down and kiss the ground. He goes on to say, "Libi b'mizrach ve'anuchi b'sof ma'arav." My heart is in the east, while I'm at the end of the west. Ech ashalem nedarai ve'sarai be'od tzion b'chevel edom va'ani b'chevel arav. He says, "How can I repay my or pay? How can I pay my vows and my commitments, seeing that?" At the time of the temple, when you wanted to bring a sacrifice, you make a vow, you want to bring a sacrifice, you have to come to the temple. And when he writes that, there's no temple, so he wants to come physically to Eretz Yisrael, and he says, how can I do that? Be'od Tzion be'Hevel Edom, the Eretz Yisrael, Tzion, is under the domain of the Christians. That was after the Crusaders took over Israel. Va'ani be'Hevel Arav, but I am bound within the Arab empire. Yekal bi'inai azov kol tuv sefarad. It is easy for me to leave behind all the abundance of Sefarad. And he lived in abundance. It was not, even though there were persecutions already at the time in Spain, Rabbi Yehuda Halevi had a very prestigious status because of his knowledge and because of his poetic ability. The Spanish Jewry cherished poetry. It was one of the most important skills that one had at the time. So he had, you know, the poet laureate that you have today, that was Rabbi Yehuda Halevi. Then that's why when he came to Mitzrayim, he stayed with one of the wealthiest people in Egypt, Netanel ben Halfon al-Levi. And during that time, all of his needs were taken care of. All of his entourage. He lived literally in a palace. And he says, it is easy for me to leave all those things behind, kemo yekar ve'inai reot afrot devir neherav, as much as it is precious for me to see the dust, the soil, or the ruins of the temple. It's really emotional to think of, you know, someone who lived almost a thousand years ago, and he speaks like that, and he took action, and he's not forgotten. We read his words, we read his poetry. It's a beautiful statement. And
Rabbi, who wrote the Chayli?
Someone else, not him. I forgot his name. Rabbi's
heart. Al-Kabetz.
No, not Al-Kabetz. It's from the same time. But not him. Anyway, Rabbi Yehuda Halevi, as I said, did that and traveled to Eretz Yisrael. And here is what he says in the book of Kuzari. This is the king talking to the Haver, the king of Kuzar. He's talking to the Jewish scholar, which is Rabbi Yehuda Halevi. So he represents the Jewish faith. And the king tells him this, the fact that you don't live in Eretz Yisrael, and by the way, those are things that I've been told also. You know, people told me, you live, you're an Israeli, you're a Zionist, why don't you live in Eretz Yisrael? And one of the reasons that I don't live in Eretz Yisrael is that I believe that there's a need in the outside Eretz Yisrael to know and to understand those things, to bring those concepts to communities outside Eretz Yisrael, especially the Sephardi communities that traditionally were very connected, but there was a certain breach with the establishment of the state of Israel, because of the way some people were treated, there's sort of a disconnect. And today in America, people associate fervent Zionism and serving in Tzal and all that more with the Ashkenazi community, the Ashkenazi schools, and less with the Sephardic communities, and that is unfortunate. So as much as I want to live in Eretz Yisrael, and that's the only place where I own property is in Eretz Yisrael, an apartment, that's what I have. There is a lot to do outside Israel, and that's part of what we read yesterday from Rabbi Uziel. He said we have a mission as a nation that is a global mission to change the world for the better. So in that sense, I combine the two approaches, that of those who say you have to be in Israel and those who say you take Eretz Israel with you wherever you are. So but the Kuzari makes this rebuke. He says, "Im ken ata mekatzer bechovat Torahtecha, she'en ata misim megamatcha makom hazeh u'simenu bepchayecha u'motecha." This is Rabbi Yehuda Levi speaking through the what we would call the devil's advocate. He says, "How can you speak about the greatness of Eretz Yisrael where when you don't aspire to be there and you don't make it the place where you live and die?" Ata omer rachem al Tzion ki bet chayenu. You say, "Have mercy on Tzion. This is the residence of our life," and you believe that the providence goes back there. So you should really go there. Says whatever you do, says bowing down, praying to Yerushalayim, this is hypocrisy. You don't really believe in the importance of Eretz Israel. And this, by the way, an argument of anti-Zionist observant Jews today, when you tell them, why don't you care about Zionism, but Israel says, what do you mean? We say every day, they say three times a day. That was army that I would hear in the yeshiva. Three times a day, they say, bring us back to Zion. The answer to them is yes. God not only brings you back to Zion, He paved the way, He paved the runway, you have El Al flights, you could go whenever you want. Right? If you really believe in it, do it. Don't say that we keep praying for it when it's right in front of you and you don't want to do it. Says so the Kuzari goes and back to tell him, your forefathers would rather live there as sojourners than anywhere else as a free residents. So because of that, Rabbi Yehuda Levi eventually traveled to Eretz Yisrael. He says, "Derashtich ve'im malkech en bach, ve'im bimkom tzeri giladech." Nahash Sarav Gam Akrav. He says, "I seek out Eretz Israel, even though the king is there no more. Even though instead of the Tzri Gilad, you know what is Tzri Gilad? Those are the special balms and oils that would come from the Gilad from the north of Israel. But now they are gone. It's devastated. It's desolate. Instead, you have Nahash Sarav Gam Akrav, serpents and scorpions." He says, "I don't care. I will go there." Halochen nitna kedem la'avod v'chulan nachalat kotzim v'chochim. When it was given to our forefathers in the past, it was also full of thorns and thistles. V'hem mitalechim orka v'rochba kemitalechim b'fardes ben tzemachim. But for them, it was like living in orchards. V'sham mitalechu lifnei Adonai v'lamdu ha'shevilim ha'nechuhim. And then they walked with God and learned the right path. So, interesting how this, like I said, hundreds of years later, reverberated in our culture, in our history. People went to Eretz Yisrael when it was not very habitable. There were swamps, there were enemies. They came from all over the world and were willing to work the land, to work hard. There's a beautiful poem by Uri Tzvi Greenberg, another poet that was sort of a little forgotten in the sense of deserving the title of the national poet, and that because at a certain point his views became too radical, too right-wing for some people in Israel. The
religious?
No. In terms of being a militant.
No, he was religious?
He was deeply religious, but not orthodox in the sense of, you know, if you would want him to see with a kippah and going to the synagogue every Shabbat, and I don't know how much observed every mitzvah, every price, but in terms of his deep spiritual conviction, it was very, very religious. His poetry when you read it, is much more powerful than many of the prayers that we read regularly. And he was also deeply affected by the Holocaust because his family was left behind. They refused to come to Eretz Yisrael. And he predicted the Holocaust already in the 1920s. If you read some of his poetry, not only predicts the Holocaust, he almost in details of how Germany will take over the world. Uri Zvi Greenberg, Atzag. So in one of his poems, he describes the work of the Halutzim, of the pioneers. And he says, we are liars. Why he calls himself a liar? He says, because every night I sit in my tent and I write a letter to my mother and my sister who are in Europe. And I tell them how beautiful it is here. How wonderful it is in Eretz Yisrael. And then, and I write with fingers that are gnarled and I can barely hold the pen because I was working so hard. We're killing ourselves. Like, there's nothing here. I mean, you really had to have conviction to continue with that. And that is something that's built over thousands of years. I just commented to Josh this morning about when I spoke about our national anthem. It's so beautiful because it's short. You don't have scroll there. And it's distilled in one word, which is the title, Hatikva, the hope. It's the only one of the probably few national anthems. I don't know all of them, but the ones that I know, and you know, their main points is war, conquering, control, or the pain of the past. None of that in our anthem. Kol od balevav penima nefesh yehudi homia. As long as deep inside you have the soul that is excited and emotionally connected to Israel. And Ayin Letzion Sofian, your eyes are lifted towards Zion. We still have hope. This is amazing. This is what maintained us. And this, in his words, is Hetzikatni Teshukati Leel Hai Leshacheret Mekom Kisod Meshihai Ad Kilo Netashtani Lenashek Bnei Beti Betrai VeHai. Says my aspiration to be closer to God, to the seat of the temple, was so powerful that it would not let me even bid farewell to my family and friends. Just like Lavan tells Yaakov, "Lo netashtani lenashek." You didn't let me kiss them, and you took them away. Rabbi Yehuda Halevi apologized. He says, "Not everybody was willing to come with me, but I had to go to Eretz Yisrael." So may his memory and words and aspiration be blessed and guide us. They keep guiding us with the tikva, with the hope, and we celebrate this Yom HaAtzmaut and many more to come. Amen. 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 Amen.